the Feast of the Tabernacles was being celebrated in the temple and in the city of Jerusalem. The Feast of the Tabernacles was a harvest festival. The pious Jews came to the temple to offer their first fruits. First fruits meant part of the harvest they earned during that season. They came to the temple with the first fruits. It could be some grain or some vegetable or some money or whatever they earned in that season. They came to the temple in a line. They offered the first fruits on the altar and they went back. And Jesus was standing in the temple, looking at everyone coming in and everyone going out. One thing Jesus noted, the people came in, they did the offering, and they went back. They went back exactly as they came in. There was no change in them. They came in sad and sick, tense and angry, anxious and afraid. They did the offering on the altar, yes, but the offering did not bring about any transformation in their lives. They went back with the same tension, same anger, same sin. An offering that does not transform the offerer is an empty ritual. This useless ceremony went on in the temple for 7 days. On the seventh day, Jesus stood up. And Jesus exclaimed, "If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. Out of me will flow rivers of living water." Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. "You who are tired and burdened, come to me, and I will give you rest. I will comfort you." The comforter is the Holy Spirit. An invitation and a promise. An invitation to come to Jesus. An invitation to offer. To offer all the tiredness, all the burdens, all the hunger, and all the thirst. An assurance, this offering will be accepted and they would be transformed. They would be comforted. Rivers of living water will flow from within Jesus upon everyone offering themselves in the hands of God. Jesus was giving a promise. A promise of a new offering, a new type of offering, where the Lord will accept our offering and change us totally. That offering took place on Calvary. On Calvary, Jesus offered himself on the cross. And we are invited to offer ourselves with the wounds of Jesus to the Heavenly Father, with the promise we will be healed, we will be forgiven, we will be given eternal life. A promise that reached all the way to the cross of Calvary and the Last Supper. In fact, in the previous chapter, John chapter 6, Jesus multiplied bread and fish. A large gathering of 5,000 people were fed. The next day, the crowds came back. And Jesus saw them coming, and Jesus knew why they were coming. And Jesus said to them, "I know you are searching for me because you had your fill yesterday of the earthly bread. Don't look for me to feed you with earthly bread every day. That's not what I'm come for. I'm come to give you eternal life, life in the full. And for this, I will give you a heavenly bread. The heavenly bread that I'm going to give you is my own body. And the heavenly drink that I'm going to give you is my own blood. You must eat of my body. You must drink of my blood. And thus, you must become one with me. When you become one with me, you will live as I live because of the Father. You will live because of me. This eternal life is what I'm come to give you. Understand me, you are dying. All the earthly food that you take will bring you to the tomb, and there you will perish. I don't want you to die and perish. I want you to live forever. And the only way to live forever is to be united with me. And for this, you must eat of my body and drink of my blood." When Jesus said this, many of those people who came in search of him, they began to say to themselves, "This is a hard saying. We can't understand this. What does this man mean? That we must eat of his body and drink of his blood?" For the Jews, to eat of human body and to drink of human blood was an abomination. They could not understand this. They walked away. Even some of the close followers of Jesus, even they walked away from Jesus. Jesus saw them going. He did not call them back. He did not call them back. Neither did he take his promise back. Rather, he affirmed and reaffirmed that promise of the heavenly bread. He turned to the 12 apostles standing with Simon Peter. He asked Simon, "Simon, are you also going away? If you want, you may go. But understand me, you are dying. The only way for you to live is to eat of my body and drink of my blood. If you don't believe this, you also may go." Simon Peter said, "Master, going away, where to? You have the words of eternal life." And they remained with Jesus. These 12 apostles had the great blessedness to eat and drink of the body and blood of Jesus. When Jesus, during the Last Supper, took the bread, broke the bread, blessed, and gave it to them and said, "Take it and eat it. This is my body." He took the cup of wine and blessed it and gave to them and said, "Take it and drink it. This is my blood." They ate and drank of the body and blood of Jesus. in the form of bread and wine. Hallelujah. 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 My dear sisters and brothers, today we want to reaffirm our faith in the Holy Eucharist, that the Holy Eucharist is truly the body and blood of Jesus. Jesus is really present in the Eucharistic bread and Eucharistic wine. A lot of people down the centuries have walked away from Jesus, have walked away from the Holy Eucharist. The Pentecostals, some of the Protestants, they reinterpret the words of Jesus and said, what Jesus meant was that the bread is only symbolically the body of Jesus, only symbolically the blood of Jesus, not really the body and blood of Jesus. They also have a communion service when they come together, but that's like having a party, eating together. It is not the body and blood of Jesus that they eat and drink. Even churches have walked away from Jesus, but some of them are coming back to the Holy Eucharist. You may have read this news item. Benny Hinn, one of the most famous preachers, Pentecostal preachers, Benny Hinn has written a new book by name The Blood. And he was speaking of this new book in the social media. You may have seen this on the social media. And he said, I believe Jesus is truly present in the Holy Eucharistic bread and Eucharistic wine. And he continued saying, today in the Catholic Church there are more healings, deliverances and blessings because the Catholics believe truly that Jesus is present in the Holy Eucharist. And he continued again. He said, Jesus took the bread in the Last Supper and did not say, this is symbolically my body, this is symbolically my blood. Jesus said, this is truly my body and my blood. And he said, the Pentecostal churches have made a mistake. And because of this, they lack the blessings of the Lord. The Catholic Church is true in the interpretation of the Word of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Let's pray, my dear sisters and brothers, that everyone may open their heart. Everyone who believes in Jesus, open their heart to their faith in the Holy Eucharist, that the Holy Eucharist may become a great blessing for everyone who believes in Jesus. But dear friends, Jesus, after giving the apostles his own body and blood in the form of bread and wine, Jesus said something very special. Jesus said, do this in memory of me. Shall we repeat that verse? Do this in memory of me. Do this in memory of me. That's what we are here for today. We come here, we are gathered around this altar to remember, to celebrate a great memory. What do we remember at this altar? What is the memory that we celebrate at this altar? The memory we celebrate at this altar is the memory of the Calvary event. But then it's a big question, Calvary event. How can we celebrate the memory of the Calvary event? When we say celebrate, we celebrate a joyous event, right? But was Calvary event a joyous happening? Wasn't it the most cruel, the most atrocious, the most unjust event of human history? The Son of God was condemned as a criminal and crucified and eliminated the most unjust and cruel way. How can we celebrate that event? We will understand this when we look at the Calvary event from the eyes of St. John the Evangelist, St. John the Apostle, the only apostle who walked the way of the cross with Jesus and Mother Mary. Holding on to Mother Mary, he stood beneath the cross on Golgotha, taking all that agony of the Lord into his heart, the beloved disciple of Jesus. Took all that agony of the Lord into his heart and wept with Jesus and Mother Mary. But he came down from the cross of Calvary, from the Calvary Mount, and he looked at the Calvary cross. You know what St. John said? This is all love. This is the ultimate in love. This is all love. St. John did not speak of cruelty. He did not speak of injustice. He spoke of love. God so loved the world, John 3:16. God so loved the world that he sent his only son to die to make sure that we do not perish. This is the ultimate sacrifice God could offer for us. Sacrifice is the measure of love. My dear sisters and brothers, what is the measure of love? If sacrifice is the measure of love, what happened on Calvary is the ultimate sacrifice. The Son of God offering himself, even the last drop of his blood, offering himself for our salvation. We always say in the plural, for our salvation. True. But then in English, the plural refers to a crowd. So as if I'm not involved, I'm not part of it. Therefore, St. Paul put it in personal singular. St. Paul said, my Jesus is crucified with me. I'm crucified with him. My Jesus offered himself for me. You and I, every one of us should be able to say this, should be able to feel this. There's a beautiful hymn, Above All. I'm sure you have heard this hymn, Above All. The hymn narrates the different moments in the passion, suffering, and death of Jesus. How Jesus was betrayed by Judas, denied by Simon Peter, condemned by Pilate, flogged at the pillar, crucified on Calvary, and buried. After having narrated all the different moments in the passion of Jesus, the hymn climaxes in a beautiful little verse. Above all, he thought of me. above all he thought of me. This one little verse expresses the whole meaning of the passion and death of Jesus. Above all, he thought of me. It is for me that he offered all that agony when he was flogged at the pillar and his body was burning with pain. Every cell of his body bruised. It was my name that was there on the lips of Jesus. When the nails were driven into his palms, it was my name that Jesus kept in his heart and offered all that agony for my salvation, for my salvation. Because who are we? We are the flock of Jesus. The flock. Jesus calls by name. Jesus knows me by name. Jesus was making sure that you, my brother, you, my sister, you and I, we should not perish. And for this, he accepted this ultimate sacrifice of love. This is how we are loved. There is an explanation some people give, that the crucifixion was a mere political crime and punishment. That's not true. Jesus said it. John chapter 10 verse 18, no one snatches my life away from me. I willingly offer it for the salvation of my sheep, the sheep that Jesus calls by name. You, my brother, you, my sister, you and I, every one of us. This is the ultimate in love. This is the way we are loved. You and I, the way we are loved. When we stand at this altar, we would understand how much we are loved. I will understand, you will understand, what is my worth? What is my value? My brother, my sister, what is your value? What's your worth? Your value is all the blood of Jesus that Jesus shed on the cross. All the blood of Jesus. It is when standing at this altar, we realize how precious, how dear, how valuable you and I are in the eyes of God. This is our value. And therefore, my dear sisters and brothers, the Eucharistic celebration is a healing service. We are healed of what? Of all the painful memories of our past. What are the painful memories of our past? The memories when we were devalued by others, when we were rejected, when we were deceived, when we were condemned by others, when we were misunderstood, when we were taken for granted. Every time I was misunderstood, I was taken for granted, I felt hurt. You felt hurt. Why? Because we knew how devalued we were. When a husband shouts at the wife feels hurt. Why is she feeling hurt? Because she knows she has no value in the eyes of the husband. The husband does not respect her. That's why he shouts at her. When a wife does not care for the husband feels hurt because he knows he has no value in the eyes of the wife. We are being devalued in our family among our friends. And when we commit a sin, we are ashamed of ourselves. I lose my value. Even in my own eyes, I have no value. My self-esteem is lost. I'm ashamed of myself. This is happening all the time. And there are painful memories. Painful memories stored up in our hearts. A bundle of painful memories. With all these painful memories, we come to this altar. With all the hurts. And here we have a celebration. A celebration of the love of our God. How much I am loved. In that celebration, all the painful memories are washed away. I understand how great I am, how precious I am in the eyes of my God. I understand how much I am loved by the Lord. Hallelujah.